Stellar Classification: What We Can Learn from Stars. This video deals with stellar classification. Before going into the merits, however, it is good to say something about spectroscopy, as it is the basis of the same stellar classification. Spectroscopy is a very powerful method of investigation of the structure of matter, which is based on the analysis of the decomposition of light emitted by it into its fundamental wavelengths, that is, on the analysis of the electromagnetic spectrum. In astrophysics, it is essential to obtain information on the chemical composition and physical conditions of stars. But what is the electromagnetic spectrum? It is the set of different types of electromagnetic radiation, each with a very specific wavelength, frequency, and energy. It consists of radio waves, microwaves, infrared, visible light, ultraviolet, X-rays, and gamma rays. Radio waves are electromagnetic radiation characterized by large wavelengths and low frequencies, while on the opposite side of the spectrum we find gamma rays with very small wavelengths and very high frequency. Our eyes are sensitive to only a small part of the electromagnetic spectrum, the visible band, characterized by wavelengths between 400 nanometers, blue-violet light, and 700 nanometers, red light. To obtain a spectrum of a star, the basic idea is to pass the starlight through a dispersive element such as a prism or a diffraction grating. In this way, the incident light beam is broken down into component wavelengths, ranging from those corresponding to radio waves to those corresponding to gamma rays. For the purposes of stellar classification, the part of the spectrum that interests us most is the one that falls in the visible band. The spectrum is closely associated with the way in which the intensity of the radiation emitted by a source depends on its wavelength. This relationship between the intensity of the emitted radiation and its wavelength can be studied by assuming that the star is comparable to a black body, that is, an ideal body capable of absorbing all the electromagnetic radiation, both in the visible and in the other regions of the spectrum. The term black body derives from the circumstance that when illuminated with light of any wavelength, it absorbs it all. By plotting the intensity of the emitted radiation as a function of the wavelength, we obtain a series of bell curves known as Planck curves, each of which represents the continuous spectrum of the star. The peaks of these curves are not coincident, but fall in a specific region characterized by a certain wavelength. In practice, each peak corresponds to a very specific set of wavelengths that which the star emits. For example, for the Sun, the Planck curve has a peak in the yellow-green part of the spectrum. This means that most of the Sun's emission falls into yellow, and that is why the Sun appears to us in this color. If, on the other hand, we were to determine that is absorbed by the chemical elements present in the star's atmosphere. Since each chemical element present in the stellar atmosphere is different, it will absorb a particular wavelength. It then becomes possible to chemically analyze the star's atmosphere. The profile and intensity of the lines also make us aware of the relative abundance of the elements present in the source, while the displacement of their wavelengths provides information on the motion of the source itself with respect to the observer through the study of the effect, Doppler. Based on these considerations, between 1862 and 1868, the Italian Father Angelo Secchi drew up a first stellar classification based on the spectra of more than 4,000 stars. 1. Almost continuous spectrum with few lines, the most intense of which are due to hydrogen. 0 stars, the lines of the Balmer series of hydrogen show their maximum. The K line of ionized calcium grows over the whole class. 2. Spectrum similar to the solar one, characterized next to lines weaker than hydrogen by a large quantity of metallic lines, sodium, calcium, iron, and many other thin ones, yellow or orange stars such as the Sun, Capella. 3. Spectrum with many thin lines and also with very wide and shaded lines called bands, with traces of metals and hydrocarbons, orange or red stars such as Betelgeuse, Antares, Miracetti. 4. Spectrum with bands due to carbon but without metals. Secchi's classification, initially welcomed with great favor, was then subjected to revision, but it was also a very important initial step, since it was the first to highlight that the behavior of the spectral lines, number, position, and intensity, depends on the color of the star. Over time, spectroscopes were increasingly improved, and by the end of the 19th century, the details visible in stellar spectra were so rich that they required an adequate classification for new discoveries. The Observatory of Harvard College at that time became the center of a monumental classification activity, which by its director, Edward Pickering, and his collaborators led in 1890 to a new complex classification into 16 classes, distinguished from as many letters of the alphabet. Later, 1901, one of Pickering's collaborators, Annie Cannon, revisited and considerably simplified the classification previously carried out, bringing it to the familiar and still, albeit with some modifications, adopted seven-letter classification, OBAFGKM. Famous is the nursery rhyme invented to remember the order of letters and classes. I'll be a fine girl, kiss me. And what rhyme would you invent to remember the order of the spectral classes? Miss Cannon's classification was a true masterpiece of simplicity and efficiency, as the order of the classes was at the same time a chromatic order, that is, of temperature and of complexity of the spectra and lines. It then passes from white, blue, and white stars of very high temperature and relatively simple spectra with few lines to yellow and then red stars with a lower surface temperature and more complex spectra, with many lines or with molecular absorption bands. To better divide each single class, additional numbers have been introduced, from 0 to 9, which divide each class into tenths. For example, an A5 star indicates a star halfway between an A0 and an F0, while an A2 indicates an A-class star that is 2/10 cooler than an A0. In fact, lower numbers indicate hottest stars within a given class. The gigantic work culminated in the magnificent Henry Draper catalog, published between 1918 and 1924 by Pickering and Cannon, which showed the classification made by the latter out of 225,300 stars. Here is the scheme. O, presence of strong absorption lines due to ionized helium. There are absorption lines of ionized helium and hydrogen. The stars belonging to this class have surface temperatures between 28,000 and 35,000 kelvins. Remember that 0 kelvins correspond to 273.15 degrees Celsius. B, hydrogen lines grow. The three helium lines are at their maximum intensity in B2. They disappear completely in B9. The lines of ionized silicon, oxygen, and magnesium are visible. Surface temperatures range from 10,000 Kelvin to 28,000 Kelvin. A. In class A0, the lines of the Balmer series of hydrogen show their maximum. The K line of ionized calcium grows over the whole class. Surface temperatures are between 7,500 Kelvin and 10,000 Kelvin. F. Hydrogen lines decrease. Ionized calcium lines increase. The first lines of metals appear. Stars of this class have surface temperatures between 6,000 Kelvin and 7,500 Kelvin. G is the class to which the Sun belongs, G2. The lines of hydrogen are further decreasing. The K line of the stock is strengthened. Present numerous lines of neutral metals. Surface temperatures range from 4,900 Kelvin to 6,000 Kelvin. K, the lines of metals grow while those of hydrogen disappear. Surface temperatures are between 3,500 Kelvin and 4,900 Kelvin. M, corresponding to group 3 of Secchi. The titanium oxide bands faded towards red, grow for the whole class. Surface temperatures are less than 3,500 Kelvin. Would you be able to indicate the name of a star belonging to each of the spectral classes? Write it in the comments. Later, further modifications were made and a parallel classification was added to the main one. Among the additions, we remember the class S, with characteristics similar to M and K, and with an abundance of zirconium oxide. The classes R and N, including stars with a high carbon content, and the W group, which some consider a variant of the O class, but it creates a real class of its own. The very hot Wolf-Rayet stars belong to it, and their spectra have large emission lines. Here are the salient features of these additional classes. W, Wolf-Rayet stars characterized by wide bands of hydrogen and helium. There are two subclasses, WC and WN, which show evidence of carbon and nitrogen respectively. R, intermediate class between G and N. N, stars corresponding to Secchi group 4 with spectrum characterized by the bands of carbon compounds. S, characterized by the zirconium oxide bands. However, this classification only considers the temperature of a star and says nothing about their brightness, or if you want their size, or even better, the width of certain spectral lines. For this reason, a parallel classification is also used. In it, Roman numbers from 1 to 5 indicate with the same spectral class the brightness and dimensions of the star. Class 1 is also known as the supergiants, very bright. To class 2 belong luminous giants, to 3 giants, to 4 subgiants, and to 5 dwarfs, or main sequence stars. Less frequently, 6 subdwarfs or small dwarfs and 7 white dwarfs are also used. Sometimes the 0 number relating to hypergiants is also added, but the symbol creates some confusion, since a star of class O letter can also become O0 if it is at maximum temperature. They are also used under brightness classes. The 1 splits into 1A and 1B to further divide the supergiants. At this point, our Sun becomes a G25, which translates into yellow star, 2/10 towards orange, main sequence dwarf. We also summarize the brightness classes. Hypergiants, 0. Supergiants, 1A, 1B. Luminous giants, 2. Giants, 3. Subgiants, 4. Dwarf or main sequence stars, 5. Subdwarfs, 6. White dwarfs, 7. Thanks to these two classifications, it is possible to take a step forward by inserting in a Cartesian diagram the spectral classes or temperatures in abscissa and luminosity, or the absolute magnitude or indirectly the diameter. In the ordinate, it is possible to construct the Hertzsprung diagram Russell, also known as HR diagram. Ejnar Hertzsprung and Henry Norris Russell independently conceived it around 1910, plotting the temperature of stars and their absolute magnitude. This was obviously done only for objects whose spectrum and distance were available. However, it was enough to understand from the outset the enormous potential of it. The stars did not position themselves at random, but followed precise and clearly identifiable lines and groupings. The HR diagram is an essential tool for understanding the evolution and physical characteristics of individual stars and stellar agglomerates, open clusters, globular clusters, and galaxies. Thanks to the HR diagram, it is possible to compare the theoretical predictions of stellar evolution models with observations to verify the accuracy of the former, determine the age, chemical composition, and distance of a stellar population, derive the history of the star formation of an agglomeration of stars, etc. From a first examination of the HR diagram, one immediately observes how the stars tend to position themselves in a very distinct region. The predominant evolutionary structure is the diagonal, starting from the upper left corner, where the most massive, hot, and bright stars are located, towards the lower right corner, where the less massive, cooler, and less bright stars are positioned, called the main sequence. At the bottom left is the sequence of white dwarfs, while above the main sequence, to the right, the red giants and supergiants are arranged. Be sure to join the channel, leave us a like, and click on the bell. You will help us to make products of even higher quality.